Good evening, everyone. We welcome you all to Monday Motivation Webinar Series. This is the Season 2, Episode 2, as Dr. Tushar would like to call it. So to introduce today's speaker and the moderators, I hand over to Dr. Tushar Agarwal.
Hi, guys. Welcome aboard again. And thanks for spending time with us. Thanks for being with us. Today, we have a very special guest, Dr. Sameer Dalwai, who's my batchmate, classmate, a deep friend, a very dear friend, and we've been remaining. Sorry for the. And we've been friends for endless number of years. He is a leading developmental pediatrician, famous nationally and internationally. Am I audible? Because I got.
Yes, you are fully audible. Go ahead.
So, to formally introduce him, so Dalwai is now the founder director of New Horizons Child Development Center. And he is, and he is a consultant at Hinduja Nanavati Hospital. He is a joint secretary, national joint secretary, IAP. He is the GOI Rajiv Gandhi Awardee, Manav Seva Award for Services to Children 2012. Besides all the awards, I think the leading thing is that he's taken a different path altogether, and he's into developmental pediatrics, which as we go ahead, we'll come to know. And sorry, there's a disturbance on my computer. Sorry.
Okay. So somebody is calling him on the computer somehow. His phone has got connected to the computer somehow. Tushar, you can unmute yourself and then talk. Tushar, you have to unmute yourself.
Yes, better call him.
No, I am just sending him. Yeah, here he is.
Am I audible?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. So, sorry about that. Was the introduction of Sameer audible at that time, or that was not?
Yes.
Yes. Audible.
Okay. So now, Atul, my other dear friend and also very closely associated with Sameer, is also there with us, and Dr. Barkha, who has been with Dr. Sameer Dalwai for years, is also there with us. So today there was a question from Sameer that whether we should have a PowerPoint presentation or question answer session. So we thought that it will be very easy to talk to him, and that way we can actually ask him what we really want to know. And because he's in developmental pediatrics, the chief thing which is on the top of our mind is what is the impact of so much of onslaught of online education on kids in the short term, in the intermediate term, and in the long term. So the first question to you, Sameer, would be that can you tell us whether there is any impact on the focus and attention span in kids with so much of online education? Or do you think it is decreasing, increasing? They are finding it difficult to sort of retain their focus.
Good evening to everybody, my dear friend and brother Tushar, Dr. Atul. And somebody who's been my senior, a couple of years senior to me and Tushar, and we've passed MBBS reading your notes. Dr. Neeraj, good evening to you, and my dear colleague, Dr. Barkha Chawla, and all of you at Ortho TV. It's wonderful to be here on this platform. Tushar and I have been planning this for a long time now, but akhir aaj muhurt nikla us baat ka. So thanks, Tushar, for this. And it's a wonderful pleasure to be here with all of you guys. You've asked a very relevant question, and I'm sure as parents, everybody is worrying about it, about the impact of online education in children and what is the impact it has. So there are two questions in your question, Tushar. One is the impact of too much of online digital exposure and the effect on education. Both of them have to be seen differently as well.
Okay.
The simple part being the other one, what is the impact of education being online? So, well, we must know that a large part of education is beyond the books, and that part has been missing. So again, Tushar, if you permit me, I remember a share, so let me just say it. धूप में निकलो घटाओं में नहा कर देखो जिंदगी है क्या किताबों को हटा कर देखो. तो अब उसको चेंज करके मोबाइल को हटा कर देखो ऐसे बोलने वाली बात है. सो दिस इज समथिंग विच चिल्ड्रन आर मिसिंग बिकॉज द लाइफ दैट दे हैव इन स्कूल विद देयर फ्रेंड्स विद देयर पीयर्स विद देयर टीचर्स द फ्रेंडशिप्स दैट दे हैव द फाइट्स दैट दे हैव देन दे रिजॉल्व देयर फाइट्स एंड ऑल द अदर थिंग्स आर दे आर मिसिंग एंड स्पेशली द एडोलेसेंट्स दोज ऑफ यू हु हैव किड्स बियॉन्ड यू नो द टीनेज किड्स बिकॉज all of you remember like Tushar said we've been together from 11th so the best part of your life the best friendships of your life are typically formed in your teenage life so all these the children are missing plus they are also missing the exam related stress but coming to Tushar's particular question of online learning what has happened is education having gone online has kind of legitimatized looking at the screen throughout the day. So 4 hours, 5 hours, we see our children having an excuse to be in front of the screen. And then again, they can't go out, so can't have any physical play. So they're in front of the screen again all through the day. And we've seen a huge spike in the increase in screen addiction just in the last 1 year of the pandemic. Now, the addiction to the screen has various issues. But in short, it completely rearranges the programming of the child's brain. Let me start with a young child. And we have children now in India as young as 3 to 4 months of age. I think Barkha will agree with me. At 4 or 5 months of age, they are being shown a tablet or a mobile phone for the sole purpose that the child eats a lot. So the importance of eating, unfortunately, in our culture for a child is so much that the screen is something that the child is just looking at the screen and eating away. And also sometimes there are so many things to do in the house. So it's easier for the parent to be able to manage a child like that. The effect of this in infancy being shown the screen so much is that children are not learning the normal social communication milestones the way they should. Ideally, you should be looking at people around you, interacting with people around you at 2 months, 3 months of age and learning to look at them and learning to interact with them. Gradually, the child sees how those people are behaving, how they interact with each other, how they behave in the house, how they sit at a table and eat, what are their manners, what are their habits. Over a period of a few more months, the child then observing the parents understands non-verbal communication, all the actions that we do. And thereafter, the child learns verbal communication. But now we are seeing children who are being put on the screen as early as 5-6 months are getting messed up in their social communication milestones and would come to us at 16-17 months of age saying that my child doesn't have good eye contact or doesn't have a good social smile or he wants to be focused on his screen. And this is, some people call it virtual autism. It's not autism, but it looks like autism because the child has just not been able to develop the normal milestones. So all of us, I'm sure as orthopedicians know the simple thing that if the parent is carrying the child around in his arms all the time, the child will learn to stand late or walk late. This is understood. Similarly, the child who is not focusing on the parents, but is focusing only on the mobile will learn to speak late. And it's being seen very commonly as one of the causes of delayed development, delayed speech. Going ahead, older children, we see them getting more and more irritable. As Tushar rightly mentioned, the attention span gets reduced because the child now has a remote, the child has the buttons, the child is just switching over. And even if he's not switching the channel, what he's seeing on the screen is a very dynamic picture because you have multiple colors, you have sounds, you have the animation. And that is artificial, but it is so attractive that the child can't look away because it's targeting your ANS, autonomic nervous system, and it's triggering your flight and fight reaction. So you get hooked onto it. It gives you pleasure. So there's a dopamine going and you can't look away. But don't miss the fact that this heightened sense of awareness is actually impacting the child's nervous system. And that leads to disorders in self-regulation, of concentration, attention span, and very importantly, disorder in sleep. Because that knocks out the child's sleep pattern, the increased hyperarousal just before bedtime. So all these things have a long-term impact, especially on the brain of a young developing child.
So Samir, this leads us to the next question. At what age does a self-regulatory mechanism sort of come into the kids? When do they know that, you know, I have to keep my video switched on. I have to pay attention to my teacher when the class is going on. Because I'll tell you from my own example is that it's a huge effort to make my son keep his video on, you know, all the time. And I see there are these four or five kids who are so bright in his class, who are always alert. So is this, at what age should ideally be you be so aware that, you know, you have got to keep your video and this is the way I'm going to get educated? So is it 11, 12? Is there a specific age at which this milestone should come?
So Tushar, unfortunately,
from right or wrong, what is good for me, you know?
So Tushar, unfortunately, the parameters by which we judge whether the child can understand what is good or bad for himself, the parameter itself which we use is always generally education, and that's not a good idea. Because a human being biologically hasn't been designed to study in a classroom of 50 children studying algebra, geometry for hours together and going and reproducing it in an exam. That's not why the human body was designed or the human brain was designed. And hence, if you have a parameter of education, this is the first thing, Varkha will agree, that we try to do with our parents is we try to make them understand that don't measure everything through education. Because unfortunately today, education has got such a huge role in success in society, so to speak, that parents only see that as a measure of the child's ability to be successful in life. And in fact, just before I got here, there was a show we were talking about the 12th standard exams, the CBSE exams, and the government is in a big quandary whether to hold the exams or cancel them in the wake of the onslaught of COVID. And the trouble is parents themselves still want to have the exam because everything revolves around the 12th standard marks. But it's not the 12th standard marks. These same children and parents have been worried about the marks from grade 1 onwards. From grade 1 onwards, they've been preparing for it. So don't look at the child only from an exam point of view. So coming back to how do you then look at it? The child is designed to grow up, and all of development is acquisition of new skills and new functions. And what are these new skills designed for? To acquire new functions. And why do we want these new functions? So that the child can survive in the environment. For example, a child who's happy lying on his back at 3-4 months of age, why do you think he sits up at 7-8 months of age? One would think, oh, to hota hi hai, but there's no chip in the brain and no signal from Microsoft that at this 6 months you have to start sitting up. The reason for the child wanting to sit up is when he's lying on the ground, the mother goes out of sight, goes out of the room. He can't see her and he keeps crying for the mother. But he can't look beyond that because he's only a few inches off the ground. It's only when he can raise himself up. It's like going on top of a tower. When you go on top of a tower in a fort, you're able to see at a much larger distance around you. So the child's ability to sit up gives him a better view over what's happening. Is the mother close by or no? Should I cry now? Or it's no point crying because she's not around in sight at all. The moment the mother enters the room, then the child starts crying. So this is a skill that the child acquires, or a function the child acquires, to be able to be better in control. Why does a sitting child then want to stand up? Because when he reaches out for something, probably in the caveman days, the banana or whatever else was just out of his reach, he had to really grab something and stand up just to increase his reach. And that is perhaps how evolutionarily the child learns to stand up. And then why does he learn to walk? Because if the thing is on the other side of the room, he needs to move across to get the apple or the banana or whatever he wants to eat. And this is how the child develops. Similarly, the question of attention. When the child at a young age doesn't have the capacity to pay attention because there's no probably felt need to pay attention. And hence, all skills, all development is not only biological. It's largely environmental. And that's why I gave that example. We all know ki jis ghar mein bahut log hai, bachche ko god mein carry kar rahe, wo bachcha late khada rehta hai, late chalta hai, kyunki usko exposure hi nahi mila. It's the same with every mental, cognitive, social communication development. The child needs to be given enough opportunity. And hence, it's very important to keep speaking to the child, to interact with the child, and involve the child in day-to-day activities. Because these are our human social day-to-day activities. If the child is involved in these natural day-to-day activities, automatically his attention span starts getting programmed to completing those activities. If he's going to be sitting with the family and having a meal, automatically over a period of time, his attention span, his restlessness goes down, his sitting tolerance gets programmed to that much time because it's needed. And it's ingrained in him gradually by purpose and by need meaningfully. Now, all of this gets rocked out when you have an artificial way of growing the child either with the digital media or only academics. So Tushar, there is no one particular age of self-regulation because there is no one particular measure of self-regulation. And hence we know as a child develops, the attention span keeps increasing step by step by step. And that's why you have a child in say the, when we put him in a kindergarten, we know that at this age, he can only focus for a little span of time. So we have smaller rhymes that the child can learn. As the child goes in grade one, not only the hours of school increase because now the child can sit for longer, but also the teaching that happens gets bigger and bigger till the time he comes to grade 10. So attention span and self-regulation increase with period of time, but not independently of environment. So it's not just a function of age. So the chronological age isn't very important. What's important is a developmental age. At what age does the child learn this part? And the final thing in this, what you said about self-regulation is something called instant gratification. A child who's about a year or 2 year old sees a cake and he just wants to grab it and eat it. He may not realize it's hot and he may burn his fingers. He will not be able to postpone his gratification. The moment he sees the cookie, he wants it. It's over a period of time that he learns that and that's where parents say that, wait, it's not time yet. If you wait, I'll give you two. It takes the cognitive level to increase to the fact that he says, look, if I rush now, I'll get one. But if I wait, I'll get two. This is how the child's self-regulation builds up over a period of time. So the answer is having the child involved in household chores. And Baraka will be smiling, because that's our trade secret. We get children with autism, ADHD to be involved in household chores as one of the most important things of increasing their self-regulatory behavior.
Wonderful. It's really very enlightening. One more thing I wish to ask is that I find, you know, in regard to my own kid, he just breaks off from education and starts playing games on the same online portal as which the education is going. So for him, it has become like seamless, you know, flowing from studies, breaking off, playing games, then coming back. So what is this online? What is going to be the impact of this onslaught of online games? Because my brother, who's a software engineer, he says that the richest companies on the planet are the online gaming platforms, you know, means they are. So is it good? Is it bad? Should we actively discourage them from playing online games?
So again, Tushar, earlier, I mean, maybe with the days when we were kids, teacher was teaching in the class, but outside the window, the other class had a lecture off or whatever. And those boys were on the ground playing cricket. So even that time, we had the same issue of regulation. Should we pay attention to what the teacher is teaching or look at our friends who are having fun out there? But the difference is, at that time, it was difficult for you to get out of the class and go and join them unless you did something naughty and the teacher threw you out, which was your plan. But it was difficult. Now, on a digital platform, it is seamless. So here again, it is more difficult for the child to regulate his behavior because the temptation is so easily attainable. And the trouble with digital is it's so easily temptable and it's so easy to attain the temptation that you can't stay away from it. And that is exactly why the internet gaming companies are making a fortune, because even adults can't stay away from it. At the bottom line is same, the search for dopamine or the surge of dopamine. Earlier, it used to be more difficult to acquire that or to realize that or to get that. Now, with the digital platform, all controls are so difficult, even for the child or even for the parent. And that is a real danger. So again, Tushar, the solution to that is not only forcing the child on the education, online education. You can't see Facebook or you can't switch. You have to practice that in real life beyond the screen and beyond the education. So for example, when I mentioned about household chores, we encourage the child to take part in all the household activities. For example, setting up the lunch or the dinner table. Now, that is a set of activities a child has to do. It's an executive task to be able to know which plates to get, what to keep where. After dinner or after meals, to clean up the table. Now, these are, I don't think in today's time, you might be laughing, most of you. Okay, what is this doctor telling us? He wants our child to pick up the tables, or pick up the plates from the table. If you don't do it, you are missing out on a very essential exercise for your child, which you cannot get if you pay money and come to my child development center also. Because all that I do in my child development center is artificial. And the child may learn to do it in my clinic, but he will never do it in his own house or his own school. And hence, if we want to get him to improve his regulation, don't try it at the toughest. Getting him to stop from education to going on Facebook is the toughest thing you are picking up, Tushar. What you need to do is try it elsewhere when the screen isn't there. Make him develop his self-regulation there. Make him have a schedule. Okay, you have to wake up at this point of time. After you wake up, you have to do your daily chores of life, like brushing your teeth. I mean, you'll be surprised if I tell you the number of parents who come and say that it's a chore for them to be after their teenage son and daughter to brush their teeth every morning. You may not believe it, but that's quite common. And that's because they have never set that habit. And that's because these are some things that you have to make a schedule and stick to it. And that's where the parent has to be, if I may say, a strict parent. By strict doesn't mean that you beat the child up, but you have to insist that the child do the same thing. And it's by force of habit then the child sticks to the same thing. So these are habits which we have to inculcate at home in our day-to-day life. There cannot be an artificial solution for it.
So am I to understand that we will be defining more and more patients as attention deficit kids, or because of all this purpose, because of them shifting focus very rapidly?
Yes, you would see that. But the amazing fact is that not all of them are biologically attention deficit. They aren't born with that trait. This is a programmed thing. Like I said, virtual autism. So this is a programmed thing. So when you stop it, it can revert. The difficult part is how do you stop this? And hence, the guidelines are that in the first 2 to 3 years of life, do not allow your child access to any screen gadget or any mobile gadget. Except because this time of pandemic, grandparents may be far away, you may be cut off for a video conversation. Even in that, I very specifically tell the parents, if you have a smart TV, hook your video to the TV. Because the problem is giving the child a mobile, the problem is he gets the buttons in his hand. And then even a 3-year-old child is used to pressing the buttons and moving here and there. That's where you get a 10-year-old child who is switching away from his classes to the Facebook. So have them have conversations on WhatsApp call or a video call on the bigger screen without the buttons. So these things are very important right from the beginning. And if you wean the child, and so don't allow the child to have screen below 3 years of age. Beyond up to 5 to 6 years, we say about 40, 45 minutes, always supervised. Let the parent always be there to see what he's watching. And the most important fact is making the daily schedule for everything, including waking up, brushing your teeth, helping parents in the kitchen, helping parents to do the household chores, going to the school. And within that, if you have a fixed time for TV, so TV or mobile by itself is not bad. It's the inability to regulate how much you have. So if you have a regulated schedule in terms of an overall schedule of the day, then it's easier for parents and the child himself to be able to limit his screen time to a particular time. So it's always a balance. And unfortunately, what happens, parents come and then the doctor says, okay, it's a lot of screen time. So what should we do? Oh, stop his screen time totally. And the rest of the day, let him behave weirdly. That doesn't work. First, control or help his behavior get better in the other issues, in the other battlefields of daily life. And then pick up the most difficult challenge for the child, that is the screen.
Great. Dr. Barkha, a little bit of your comments and then any question to add to the discussion.
No, I think what Sir said was right, that screen needs to be limited. There are proper guidelines which are there, which we need to be, they've been given by the American Academy of Pediatrics, and there should be no screen at all for children below 2 years. When Sir was speaking about infancy and, you know, people showing the mobile and feeding, parents get a lot of satisfaction. But I just want to add here that besides even the cognitive thing, there's a lot of obesity which happens in children, and children actually don't know that they have, when they need to stop eating and when they are full.
I'm going to show you how you can use the swipe up feature to get people to go to your links.
So there are two aspects that we may note. One, we may find obese children who are eating and they really don't know when to stop. And second, on the other hand, parents may keep complaining to you that my child keeps vomiting post meals. And here you get a child who's doing well on his growth charts. Because he's overeating at times, he doesn't know how to send, and he keeps vomiting. When we're not even focusing on the proper meals or the ADLs, we do get a lot of parents who keep complaining to us that the child has chewing concerns. And parents who keep reading a lot now on the internet will relate it to a sensory concern. They're always, I don't know, this word sensory has become very fascinating with the generation. And my child has sensory concerns with chewing. Whereas the fact becomes that we've actually not taught them how the exact process of chewing or eating a food is supposed to be. So that's just an addition.
Sameer, others also want to ask a question, but I really need to ask you this. How do you assess that this child is not going to respond to what you have just mentioned and probably he will be required to put on drugs? Do you have to put children on medicine to improve their attention focus, and do medicines help?
The secret about developmental pediatrics is that it's always in steps and always in a sequence and always a graded improvement or a decline. So if I have a child, having a problem of attention deficit or not paying attention enough, or a very hyperactive child, I will first try and see how long can he sit still. Not sitting still is a complaint or the negative part of it. But what is a developmental part of it is how long can he sit? For example, you have a child at 3 years and he's not able to walk at 3 years. That's not enough for you. You need to ask whether at least is he standing. If he's not standing, then you'll ask, at least is he sitting? And if he's not sitting, then at 3 years, you'll say this child is not sitting. You won't say he's not walking. Of course, he's not walking, but that's because he's not sitting. So you define the milestone that the child has achieved. That's the child's strength. And the way to look at a good way of looking at developmental pediatrics, at least that's what we do at New Horizons, is to find out what the child can do in terms of his developmental level. Now, once you are able to establish the fact that he can pay attention for only, say, 3 minutes, then what we do is we work on it to increase it to 5 minutes, not to 100 minutes straight away. And there are some activities for the child. There are some activities for the parents to be done at home. Over a period of time, you have to reassess. If the child's ability is increasing, then it's going along the natural curve. Then you keep on going. But the point is, parents may expect that he's not even paying attention for 3 minutes today. Next month is my school exam and he needs to pay 1 hour attention. That's where we have a problem. And those expectations are not biologically possible or developmentally possible. And then there is a failure. I tried for a month, but he wasn't able to sit for an hour. The point was, have you had a good assessment and a good projection and a plan to get towards it? If your projection or your objective or your goal was unreal, then you'll never reach it, which is why perhaps many people don't give you a goal at all. Are ye problem hai, autism hai, ADHD hai, pata nahi kitna hoga, lekin koshish karenge. That also is equally wrong, because you are not trying to get rid of the autism or the ADHD. You are only trying to improve his concentration span. And that is the way you should be looking at it. And then if you are trying to improve the concentration span, there is no reason why you cannot make a probable assumption for over a period of time. What happens is that when you have a reasonable assumption and you have a follow-up, and if you see the child has attained that, then you can continue going step by step by step, and you don't need a medication. When do you need a medication? When you don't want to follow this biological principle. And like I said, abhi 3 minute hai, next month mere ko ek ghanta chahiye. Then okay, you can take a tablet for it, which is never going to solve the problem in the long run. Or there is a genuine situation. The child has come to me only in class 10th. His exam is 2 months later. And now he's so tense that he is getting severe anxiety. But he basically has severe ADHD and he cannot focus. He's getting into fights with his parents. He's getting into fights with his peers. He's come to me at class 10th. He's already 15, 16 years old. So his programming has been done so deeply. I will need time, but I don't have that much time because he has to give an exam. He's been threatened to throw out of school because he was fighting with everybody in the school. In that case, I will start with medications as a first aid, explaining to the parents that this is temporary. But what even will help in that age is the same principle that I explained earlier. So that is where a combination works. Only treatment works where the parents say we don't care about improving the child permanently, or we don't believe we can improve permanently, or we don't want to do any therapeutic intervention program. We just want a quick result, which to me is unethical. But then that's where only the medication comes in. And then you see the result. The moment you stop it, it's as bad as it was earlier.
Neeraj, you want to ask some questions?
Yeah. So this was regarding the guidelines which Barkha mentioned of the AACP. AACP, am I right?
American Academy of Pediatrics.
Yeah, AAP.
And the IAP also has its guidelines.
Yeah. So the IAP, although my question was that those guidelines, were they formed before the lockdown or after the lockdown? or did they change after the lockdown? Because I think that there is definitely, it has to change after the lockdown because doing schooling online.
So the AAP guidelines were there before the lockdown, but they made one change in the lockdown.
Okay.
They added the fact that even below 2 years, video conversations can be allowed, but in real time. That is one part that they changed. In India, I think our IPA guidelines, but the point is, Dr. Neeraj, we must understand that this is an abnormal situation that cannot be taken to normalize biological development, which has taken human beings thousands and thousands of years. So I think the guidelines should still stand, and we should not allow this to change what is biologically normal. What we are seeing now is an environmental deviation. Because of COVID, it's necessary. A lockdown is an environmental deviation, I would say. That is not expected to be permanent, and may God make it so that it's not for long as well. And we will have to get back to that. So I don't want people to take a message as an excuse. Ki ab kya kar sakte yaar, ab to yehi hai. So I can use another logic for it. Now people don't have a chance to go out. They can't socialize. They can't do so. They are depressed. They'll start drinking. And then it has changed. Now drinking has become normal. We can't do that. So we can't use this to normalize something which is not natural.
Okay, so one last question, an extension of this. What about when you and I were in college or school, we didn't have exposure to computer. I bought my first computer after MBBS, though I was using computer before, long before that. One in school, maybe for half an hour as a computer class. And that is what, as an still an optional thing. And after that, I bought my computer, there were many people who were not having computers in the house. People used to come to my house to play games on the computers or do whatever we wanted to do, use the internet. But now when you have to start using screen for the projects, whatever you do. So is there a guideline which has got extended that you can use screen for the projects or something like that? Because a lot of projects happen on the screen now. And for the people who are poor, who cannot afford laptops in their house, they are left with a smartphone. So how does IAP, is there a overall IAP taken into consideration those people, or it's just a generalized guideline, is what I'm asking.
Your question is very practical and realistic. The answer to that can be that nothing in itself is good or bad. I mean, as they say, the fault is in yourself, not the stars. When it comes to, again, the digital media, the problem is with, like we began the discussion with, self-regulation. And we know that younger people have more of a difficulty with self-regulation than as we grow older. The point is, are you helping the child self-regulate or no? And that is where the role of the parent comes in. So it's not a blanket TV dekhne ka hi nahi. The moment your back is turned, they will find a way to do it. The idea is to help the child understand, look, this gadget is here to stay. We can either use it to benefit us or to harm us. There is no doubt about the benefit of these gadgets. The idea is to be done it in a way that the child is able to understand that I have to regulate the use of it. But like we said earlier, this regulation cannot be taught only in this battlefield. It has to be taught in all aspects of life. And it is easier to teach it somewhere where it is not so tempting as compared to TV. So if parents are aware first about the dangers of online exposure and addiction, then the second thing is, we are not saying ban devices, but be part of allowing your child to understand how to balance it. But it cannot be only balancing mobiles and non-mobiles. It's also about everything else in life.
Dr. Ashok Shyam, who is with us, is asking, can you give some practical tips on this as to how to sort of build up this kind of willpower in kids? Setting smaller tasks, helping them win those tasks, gaining confidence. Okay, I can go through this, like tiny habits, atomic habits kind of stuff.
Exactly. So keep the screen aside first and foremost. Look at what the child does in the remaining part of his life. See what the child is able to do. See what the child is good at. Make that as a benchmark. And then work towards improving each and every one of those small things. And that's where I believe you need to do this. So there are many companies who have a kit. They'll sell you a game. They'll sell you a toy. They'll sell you some educational toys. Again, it's a gimmick because it's not part of normal, natural day-to-day life. And hence the use of ADLs, that is the activities of daily life, like brushing the teeth, toilet, taking a bath, wearing your own clothes, eating with your hands, as what we call as ADLs. That is extremely important in the child's life. So when you make a schedule with ADLs in it, Then the second concept is household chores, where you are doing things for others besides only yourself, because there's no immediate benefit in that. These are extremely important to help regulate the child's overall improvement in their life. And Varkha is here at our New Horizons. I can share with you, the moment you are able to get the parents to practice a good schedule for the child. Now, look, I am nobody to tell you whether your child should wake up at 8 o'clock or 8:30 or 9. That's your choice. I am nobody to tell you whether your child should pray or not pray, or pray before breakfast or after breakfast. That's your choice. But what I'm saying is, write it down and make it a habit. The problem with children's attention span is when households are arbitrary. Kabhi karne ka ye, kabhi nahi kiya to bhi chalta hai. Sunday, kabhi bhi utho. Aaj Sunday, daant brush nahi karenge to bhi chalega. Arbitrariness is what worsens children's behavior more than screens. And that was before screens came in. So what is very important is regulate at least the child's schedule, especially his activities of daily life. So he has to do those things in the morning and the household chores throughout the day. Help him, or rather plan his day or activities in such a way that he understands. I'll tell you one last thing in this. Children at a very young age may not understand the time by the clock. So, are abhi 10 baj gaye, abhi chalo jao. He may not, a 4-year-old child may not understand that. What they do understand is, iske baad kya? So even a 2.5-year-old child, when he wakes up, understands, utne ke baad kya? Daant brush karne ka hai. Daant brush karne ke baad kya? Muh dhone ka hai. Uske baad kya? Potty pe baithne ka hai. Uske baad kya? Nahane ka hai. Uske baad kya? Kapda pehnne ka hai. Uske baad kya? Pray karna hai. Uske baad kya? Nashta karna hai. So the child may not understand nashta at 9:45. Wo andaaz apna apna mein, you have that Ram Gopal Verma. He says, har cheez time to time honi chahiye. That's not possible in a child. But he understands iske baad kya. Now there are two very important things, and this is something you must try to actually see the benefits. The child learns two things out of this. One is anticipation and one is predictability. By anticipation, the child wakes up, the first thing he wants to do is to have the TV or to play his favorite game. But when you schedule it, and in the schedule you also put that, but at a particular time, he knows right in the morning, he can anticipate ki mujhe wo milne wala hai, lekin turant nahi. It's exactly like those of us who have a salary. We may not get a salary till 30th, but you are working every day knowing that on 1st, we'll get a salary. That's anticipation. But for that to work, it has to be predictable. Suddenly on 1st, the fellow is going to give a salary as runaway, and you don't get a salary. Next month, you say, aaj ka pagar aaj hi chahiye. Because I have no bharosa. That's not predictable. So that's where parents' role come in, that you have to have it predictable. That yes, if the child has waited and delayed gratification, then you must make sure he gets what he has been promised as well. That builds in predictability, and the child knows two things. Ki jo mujhe pasand nahi hai, wo khatam hoga. Jo pasand hai, wo milega. Jo pasand hai, wo bhi khatam hone wala hai. Aur uske baad jo napasand cheez hai, wo karni padegi, lekin wo bhi khatam ho jayegi. This is one of the most important things you can improve your child's maturity, jo hum inverted commas mein bolte hai, but you can call it cognitive function if you want to use these high-five words. But hum common bachcha mature nahi hai. This is what, to a large part, helps solve the child's problem. So when you ask for a quick tip, if I am going to say order something from the internet and this game helps you, I would say no, not at all. These things may take a month, but in a month, for lifelong, you will see a great benefit. So I would say rather do these things.
And they would benefit us also, because I think it helps our willpower regulation also, which also has come down, right? Atul, your question.
Can I just add here one thing, sir? I'll just go two things, like what sir spoke about the schedule. Two things. One important is when the parents also schedule their day, keeping their child in mind and correlating how they're going to spend time with the child and how much they're going to give. I think this works best. So the parents should also schedule their day. And second is, when we've applied this to even our autistic kids, most of the behavioral concerns have reduced and it's a more peaceful and happy family.
Atul, your question?
Yes, so just, I think Samir has answered very well that there is no magic figure or timing as far as the gadgets are concerned. So, you know, my take on this is that, you know, Samir has been in this field, you know, for so many years, and you're seeing a different spectrum over the last few years of various neuromuscular conditions. But now this pandemic has given you an opportunity So it's a different kind of spectrum. Now, knowing that, you know, we all saying there's an increase in ADHD. Now, is IIT doing any kind of study? Is there any data? Because tomorrow, I'm sure, there'll be publications in various journals to say, okay, we've got X percentage increase in, you know, ADHD or learning disorders. So I just want to know whether IIP has initiated any study or whether your center has got any data which, you know, which will eventually reinforce what you're saying, because I'm sure at some point that will become important. And the second point is, you know, with this COVID, there are a lot of labeling of things. For example, you know, you've got new labels coming out with COVID, the COVIDiots and, you know, remdesivir and sanitization. Are there any changes, you know, since your thing is labeled enabled? Are there any new labels being put to disorders in the pandemic, you know, which were not existing earlier, and whether something which we have to become mainstream eventually, because, you know, screen time is not going to come down. So what are your thoughts about any studies being going on nationally, in the city, and whether there's any new labeling of disorders which, may come up, become mainstream?
So that's a very good question. One of the things that might become so-called normalized, or what we may, I hope it doesn't happen, but is afraid can be happening more normal or being looked at more normal, is anxiety. And behaviors coming out of anxiety may be considered to be more abnormal, or maybe considered to be more acceptable perhaps, because everybody is exhibiting it today. And if you see, there was a study done of 25,000 children, which showed that they looked at psychosocial impact in children. And 79 point something, almost 80% of children showed some psychosocial impact of COVID. About 40% showed anxiety, 40% showed depression, and a host of other things. And this study is in the public domain. Many other studies are ongoing. At our center, what we are doing is we've actually come up, and we also had to innovate because the center had to shut down. And we started teaching or working online for children with special needs. Immediately in the first 1 or 2 months, we realized that this is a disaster. It's not going to work, because what you actually do with a child face to face, it cannot be done by putting the child in front of a screen and yourself in front of a camera. That doesn't work. What we very quickly discovered is what works is training parents. In fact, now we've got a program, like you mentioned, we believe in this from label to enable. So that's been our tagline for long. So we've made a program called E-Nable, as in e-medicine, enable parent coaching program. And we've got children from all across the world now, maybe about 100 or so, not very large numbers yet, because people still can't believe the concept that things like autism, ADHD can get better remotely. But if you are able to understand the concept of which stage of normal development the child is on, and not just the abnormality in terms of a diagnosis, because when you say autism, then you're looking at a diagnosis, then immediately you will try to cover it up by saying it's a spectrum. Whatever, now leave all that and see what is the normal thing in the child. Don't try to fit the child into a diagnosis or a diagnosis onto a child. Look at what the child can do normally. If you're able to establish the developmental stage the child is, and if you're able to train the parents on what needs to be done to take him to the next level, and then the next level, and then the next level, we are seeing amazing results in children continents away only by training their parents. Of course, the problem here is that parents have to be aware. They need to be able to give that much time, because whatever we are coaching them, they need to do with the child throughout the day. And we are seeing, in fact, some results better than when the same child was coming to our center physically before the lockdown. But the parents need to have that kind of time. They need to have that kind of commitment and involvement. There needs to be a loving, fostering, safe, secure environment at home. So this is what we are publishing already, some of our data, as how we are able to work with children if we target these specific qualities. But what I'm afraid might happen is a lot of these self-harm, a lot of a bit of micropsychosis, if you may call in older children, a lot of dramatic expression, all triggered by anxiety, may be seen as normal. And I wish and hope that we are wise enough to realize that these are only the manifestations. The problem behind all of this is anxiety.
And one point is, you're seeing children from various streams, you know, from the SSC medium, the IB medium, maybe vernacular medium. Are you seeing any difference in the impact of the education stream versus vis-a-vis anxiety, this pattern? Is there anything, because the pressure may be less in SSC, more in IB. So is there any kind of micro data analysis where you can pinpoint that, okay, this child may be high risk, potentially he's got more, you know, he's from IB stream or whether he's from SSC stream. Considering they all have laptops, I'm assuming everybody's got digital exposure. So are there any pointers there, any data stratification?
So again, Atul, this was studied even earlier. And eventually what I believe matters is the atmosphere at home, rather than which, what school the child goes to and what is the curriculum in the school. And I'm talking about the large number of children. Of course, one child perhaps who was subnormal goes to a particularly high educational school will have a trouble. That's, leave that out. Over a period, over generalizing, it's the atmosphere at home that actually impacts or makes up the child's mental makeup more than the school. And even in the pandemic, the families which were well adjusted before the pandemic, they may be a laborer's family or they may be a very high business tycoon's family. Families who are well adjusted before have come out, the children have come out stronger. Families who may not have been well adjusted but who saw the writing on the wall, key boss, now we have to be hankered up at home and we have to manage. And they quickly set about re-establishing a new schedule and getting their things going, cooperating husband and wife, cooperating with each other, things like that. Even those children have shown a phenomenal gain, in fact. But families who were dysfunctional earlier, but it was not seen by the child, suddenly now when everybody is at home, they are seeing these fights, they are seeing substance abuse, they are seeing verbal abuse. These children have in fact deteriorated even worse. And hence, whichever school the child may go to, the most important thing as and when school starts is, the first most important thing is of course vaccination. The second thing is, do not rush after curriculum. That's a gross error that we may do. The first thing children will need is now renormalization. See, when the lockdown happened in March 2020, we had no choice. We had to just hunker up at home. Now when they're getting back to school, it will be again a change because it's been more than a year and a half, perhaps two by the time they do go back. They will need acclimatization. They're not used to seeing so many children around. It, again, it might be like an artificial autism because you're not used to have so much of social interaction. Children may have a digital withdrawal if they go to the school because suddenly now they don't have a screen. And they may want to sit in a classroom with a laptop like this. A teacher udhar sikha raha hai, main mera laptop mein dekh raha hun. You never know. So the first 15 days, the schools, I hope the governments are listening and they say no academics, just let the kids hug each other and, you know, you just play with each other and chat with each other. This renormalization phase is going to be very important.
A huge impact is on the exams, you know, because it's such an open kind of exams. Kids feel ke padh ke fayda kya hai, main to book khol ke baju mein rakh ke likhne wala hu abhi exam. So how, what is going to be the impact of this on the education? Means that it's happening at my house, you know, because half of the time my wife is telling him, "Acha, ye question ka answer aisa," and he is expecting her to help him out, you know, in the exam. So this is actually a realistic problem. I'm sure many people must be facing.
I'd like to say that we must understand that this is not a permanent problem. This is going to go away. Aaj nahi to kal, it's definitely going to go away. And I'm sure once vaccination comes in, I mean, I'm not talking only out of a great sense of umid as such or in the air. You see in the United States or you see in England today, it's come back to normal. The deciding factor was vaccination. Once we have a vaccination here, I'm sure things will come back. But what has happened is that the break has been so big that renormalization will be an important aspect which we cannot ignore. And we will have to plan that going back again very carefully. So like you said, the child is now used to point kya padhne mein, waise bhi to mummy can help me, I'm at home. They may carry their same attitude when they go back to school. And we can't tell them, no, now you are back to normal life, you have to do this. No, they will take time to adjust to that. And this is where parents and teachers will have to, and let me say one thing, which I just said on that show before as well, the most important influencers in education in India are not the educationists, are not the government, are not the boards. The most important influencers are parents, especially in the private segment. It's up to the parents to have this meeting with the school and tell the school that, look, we are not desperate to cover up 1.5 years curriculum in 6 months, because that's the surest way of driving your child up the wall. It's very important for parents to make a point to the school that, look, we want you first to get them to renormalize. This new normal, again, they'll be seeing. For example, the child being told that it's okay. You can take more time to study for an exam. You may have lesser portion for the exam, but don't depend on your mother like maybe you did earlier. You will have to accept this, that at home, they were what we would have otherwise called cheating. Now we are normalizing it. Karo ghar pe bhai, dekhe karo. Suddenly school mein jaoge to bologe cheating tha. This is going to cause confusion, and we should not do that. We should be able to stage it out in the way that, okay, that was a problem at one particular era. You are doing it there. Now gradually we have to change. So everything has to be gradual.
There's a question on a lot of kids are unable to communicate the stresses which they are feeling, the anxiety which they are feeling. So how as parents can we sort of perceive it and sort of establish a better communication with them? And before you answer that, Sameer, from all your talks, I feel there is a tremendous sort of stress built up on parents now, because it seems that we are responsible for everything that is happening. Were our parents as stressed as what we feel? Maybe
if I ask my mother, she says yes. That could be personal. No, I think what has happened is that we are moving towards obviously a more focused and a more materialistic society. So these pressures are bound to be there. And I'm not Baba Sameer that I can say that don't worry about all. These are realistic things. People are going to worry about it. But Tushar, let me come to your question about how to be alive. So why is it that children don't share their feelings with parents? One is because they perceive that their parents don't have time. Second, they perceive that the only thing parents want to hear from them is about how they fared at school, in their studies and in their exam. They don't want to hear if a five-year-old child comes and says, I saw a butterfly today. Or, you know, there was a puppy who we saw outside the school and all of us were running around that puppy. The first thing we'll say, are pagal hai, usko to katega to rabies ho jayega na. This is because parents are perpetually, especially doctor parents and teacher parents, they are perpetually in an advisor mode or in a gyan baatne ka mode. Ye karega to ye hoga. So the moment somebody comes to us now, Tushar, abhi tera hospital hai, sir. Aapka hospital hai. Some ward boy comes and says, ye machine, ye nahi chal raha hai, wo patient ye complaint kar raha hai. Your first instinct, you know now what is the complaint, because your experience. Before he finishes his statement, you have a solution ready for him. So Tushar, you are a solution provider. And it is fixed into your genes now. But children are not looking for solutions. They are just looking for you to listen to them. So you have to first stop yourself from being a solution provider. Just let them talk. That's 80% of the solution, I feel. The moment they express themselves, some children are very expressive. They will talk very quickly and very eloquently. Some children have a lot of problem being able to express themselves. They don't have very good communication skills. It's even more important to be patient in those children. And you don't need to provide every word that the child is missing. Don't do that. Again, you're providing a solution. But wait and show the child, even if you take more time, I'm here. Which tells the child, it's okay to take more time. I am not abnormal. If I'm taking more time than Barkha to say something, I'm not abnormal. Why? Because my mama is there waiting for me to finish. So I'm also normal. Whereas if the other child is फटाफट talking kind of a person, वो भी ठीक है, मैं भी ठीक हूँ. But if my mother says, अरे कैसा slowly बात करता है, वो देख कितना अच्छा बात करता है, जल्दी बोल, अच्छा ये word, अच्छा वो word, I think we are all the time trying to dispel ज्ञान and trying to pull our child. The more you pull, the more the hands will hurt, you'll have a dislocated elbow and you'll have to go to Tushar Agarwal later. So the point is, don't pull, don't push, be there so the child knows that he has to walk towards you. Show the guide, the direction. Is taraf aana hai. The child will find his way. But that requires you to have that patience and to wait. Because at the end of the day, we don't have time because we are busy earning money for their future. Most of the children, they get messed up before they are ever going to use your money. And it is of no use generally. There was a study done somewhere about children who inherited money. And they found out that more than 80% of them run out of the money left by their parents by the time they are through their middle age, if they haven't developed any skills on their own. As compared to, there was a study showed that most of the rich people were self-made people. Because when you are working towards self being made by yourself, you are actually acquiring all those skills that you need to struggle. But when you get everything ready-made, it in fact impedes you. So the whole idea here is be there for your child. Don't be a solution provider so that he can copy down what you say, go and write it in the exam in the class and come first. Be there unconditionally to listen to the child talk and join in. Achha, aise tha. Ye hum OPD mein karte na, 2 minute mein bachcha just comes and hugs us. 2 minute mein, the child who comes to our clinic, डॉक्टर साहब ये बहुत खतरनाक बच्चा है, बहुत मस्ती करता है, तोड़फोड़ करता है, सबके साथ झगड़ा करता है. यू जस्ट आस्क द चाइल्ड, बॉस क्या किया सुबह से बेटा? He'll take 2 minutes to open his mouth because he knows you are also going to judge him. The moment he says, अच्छा चाय पिया, अच्छा नाश्ता क्या क्या है, मसाला डोसा का, अरे बेटा कैसा बना था मसाला डोसा. द मोमेंट यू एंटर हिज स्पेस, ही लव्स यू. द ट्रबल इज वी वॉन्ट चिल्ड्रन टू एंटर आवर स्पेस. We are already MD, MS, blah, 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 blah. We want a child to come into our space. That's not natural for the child. So I'll end this question by, again, I repeat this all the time. There was a ghazal by Ghalib in which he says, Ye kahan ki dosti hai, ki bane hai dost naase. Naase means advisors. Ye kahan ki dosti hai, ki bane hai dost naase. Koi chara saar hota, koi gham gusaz hota. I wish there was somebody who could share my sorrow and empathize with me and sit with me and heal me. So we don't need advice. We just need somebody who can hear, who can share sorrows and joys, who can empathize with us. And that's the most important thing for parents to do. You don't need to be on the lookout for any danger. You should do it every day. You should be every day available for the child to come and speak. All of us are busy, but there must be at least some time in the day, or if not the day, at least in the week, where your child knows this is the time I can say anything. And it's not the amount of time. It's the confidence the child feels. I can tell my mother anything. Anything without being judged. That is more important.
Amazing. Amazing. Actually, I'm quite speechless at that. Dr. Barkha, would you want to add some comments before I make the final? It's 10 o'clock. So then before I finally conclude.
No, I think so. Whatever he said is just to the point. And
fantastic.
Amazing. There is nothing we can add beyond this. So, just a little, sir. It will just take 2 minutes, but I really want sir to tell about social media addiction, which we've seen, sir. We've had few patients who've come to our center, and you know, even the younger ones, and the way they've come up with social media addiction and the effects they've had. Just 2 minutes on that, because I think.
But about that girl, you can tell the one who was coming to us earlier for LD, got better, and then came with anxiety and depression. Why don't you share that one? The Bandup Clinic.
Yes. So we had one girl who came to us recently who was there with us, had ADHD, LD, got better, was doing fine in life. But with the COVID era, she was totally into the social media. So she used to write something, blog, she used to put it on her Insta, Facebook, and all her happiness was completely related to the amount of likes that she got. If she got less likes, she was absolutely distraught by the end of the day. She had these emotional changes, behavioral changes, which came up, which affected her family. And if she got more likes, it was a different day for her.
How old was she?
This girl was now 12 years. Mm-hmm. Right. And the best thing was she actually came up with the fact and told us that I want counseling. And this was one thing which we were like amazed. So sometimes we feel even with the younger generation and with the social media and so many people talking about mental health and counseling, a lot of people have even taken it like the most in thing that we should do counseling, but we should always remember it's not just about doing counseling. It's about implementing whatever has been told to you, which actually helps.
Fantastic.
You're also right, because social media gives children a very exaggerated sense of the world. And this exaggerated sense is not only positive, it's also negative. Because the child feels, you know, Tushar, I think apna baat hua tha. You know, I just a couple of years back, this is TikTok phenomenon which came up. Apna baat hua, I remember I told you ki this is mental health professionals ke liye aage ka business hai ye. Because this thing of wanting to be up there to post anything that you want without any sense of values or any sense of self-control, just so that you get a few hundred likes, and then every morning wanting to see how many likes you've got, actually your sense of happiness gets so distorted only based on those likes, which are not at all in your control. And then you have parents entering kids into competitions, and then you get these messages, my child has entered this competition, please like it. So, you know, I made a statement once and some people didn't like it. that mobiles are more dangerous than narcotics. Why are they more dangerous? For the simple reason that no parent buys narcotics for their child. Nobody will buy narcotics for their child, but you will pay 70, 80,000 to buy a mobile, a smartphone and a tablet. So be very careful about all these things and what is your child getting out of it. We have not even talked about cyber bullying and cyber crimes and all the other kinds of solicitation and the victimization that happens online. So it's very important. And the real way to break out of it is to make your child enjoy the real world. अरे ये क्या मोबाइल में पढ़ा है, हमसे बात कर. अरे बट तुमसे बात करने के लिए तुम इंटरेस्टिंग आदमी होना चाहिए ना यार. तुम इतने बोरिंग हो, तुमको तुम्हारे पेशेंट और वार्ड बॉय और नर्स और दूसरे डॉक्टर कितना पैसा कमा रहा है उससे टाइम नहीं मिल रहा है, तो क्या आके आपसे बात करूं. तो मोबाइल पे कोई फ्रेंड के साथ चैटिंग कर रहा है, पता चला वो फ्रेंड नहीं, कोई पीडोफाइल है. सो इट्स बेसिकली अप टू अस टू बी इंटरेस्टिंग इनफ टू आवर ओन चाइल्ड. And very often, you don't need to be so smart. The children are smarter. Even if you join their world, you will enjoy as well as you will learn so much, both ways. So the whole thing around is change of our own attitude rather than trying to change the child.
The addictions which we have just talked about are not only in kids, but it is there in adults as well. And I'm sure all the adults are also facing a huge problem coping with it. So today, to sum up the session, as we have to do it because we have run out of time, is that the ball lies in our court. It's not with the kids, right? The ball lies, it's all with the parents. And I agree, I myself am subject to it, and it's very tough as a parent, and you do feel like a failure actually when you are unable to sort of solve the problem for your kid, you know. But I think we have got to come up to that task, and we are the grown-ups. And we have to learn the mechanics of how to handle it and help out our kids. And whatever problems we are seeing in our kids is actually going to be solved by a change in our behavioral pattern and not necessarily his behavioral pattern. And the beauty which Samir said is get involved in the kids' world. Make yourself interesting to them rather than wondering why is he finding other things interesting. And that is a task for us, you know. Actually, we will probably need to have another program to understand how to make ourselves engrossing and interesting to our kids. So at that, you know, Samir, I'm indebted to you. It is wonderful. I don't think I would have got so much time to speak to you on this topic otherwise also. But under the pretext of this webinar, it has been immensely useful talking to you. For those people who have been our audience today, I'll earnestly request you to share this YouTube video or the Ortho TV online with your friends and colleagues. You're not going to get this wonderful advice otherwise. Each and every one of us needs it. Each and every one, irrespective of whether we have kids or we don't have kids. And a lot of this advice is applicable to us as adults as well. Tiny habits, willpower, growth mindset, everything Samir has said today. So with that, we'll conclude our session today. I thank Ortho TV, Neeraj Bijlani, Dalwai, Barkha and Atul for taking their precious time to be with us. And of course, the audience, thanks again for being a part of season 2 of Monday Motivation. And we'll come back in a fortnight with yet another interesting topic and yet another interesting speaker. Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot and good night, everyone.